Hello everyone, welcome to another episode of Chai Pe Stocks with Equity Investing, where Kalpak and I will present a new stock today. And before we get into the discussion for the day, I just want to remind you all that this particular video is in no way an investment advice. You may treat it as a piece of infotainment or, you know, as a piece of brief research that we have done. Okay, so the company for today that we are having is this company, Wonderla Holidays. Okay, they are into the amusement park business, and I would now like to ask Kalpak, how is your chai today?
Abhinit, the chai today is great. Thoda aaj late evening mein record ho raha hai. It's raining really heavy here where I live in Bombay, and the chai is hot. I am excited. It's a great company to be talking about. I'll get down to it quickly. So Wonderla Amusement Parks is the company. It is founded by Mr. K. Chittilapilli, the person you see on the right. He's also the founder and promoter of V-Guard, a very reputed business. Wonderla was started in the year 2000, and his son, so you can say it's kind of a family-run business, Mr. Arun Chittilapilli, you can see on the left. He is also one of the members of the board. He was more active in the management, but now has taken a step back for some personal reasons, I believe. This promoter group is known for its integrity, very, very good way of running their business, and they're quite reputed in the market for that. And there is a shortage of such good promoters in Indian companies especially. Another point that attests to it is you can see a photo of a kidney below. It's an amazing, unbelievable story here. Mr. Chittilapilli donated one of his kidneys to a truck driver he did not know. Because it was the right thing to do. I mean, that's just something quite unheard of from a rich, big person. Okay, so, you know, these guys, have the heart clearly at the right place, and they know their business.
Right. And now I think our viewers know what kind of a company we are going to discuss today.
Right.
So, Kalpak, yes, please.
So, yeah. So, quickly about the industry. So, amusement parks like your SL World, Imagica. Okay. India has about 150 plus parks. And it's about a 3,000 crore annual industry. However, Wonderla operates in the large park business, where you can see big roller coaster, a lot of rides. Each of their parks has about 50 rides on average. Okay, and some of the listed companies in the field are AdLabs and Nico, but they are one single park companies. Wonderla has three parks already up and running, and they have two in the pipeline. Just to give you an idea, China has about 1100 to 1200 amusement parks, and India has just 1/3 of that. It's a big opportunity. Wonderla caters to an aspirational, slightly higher end audience with, average ticket spend of about 1000 to 1200 rupees per visit. So that is the zone that we are talking about. So quite a premium product, really, really reputed in the locations that they operate in. So let's look at the locations. So they have three parks currently in Kochi, started in 2000, Bangalore and Hyderabad. So the fun thing about this is, Abhinit, all of these businesses were started through internal accruals and, the initial promoter investment. In the year 2014, the company went public to fund partially its Hyderabad park. Okay, and now it currently has three parks up and running successfully. Okay, and two parks are under development, one in Chennai, land procured and construction is on, 62 acre land. Projected capex is about 350 crores for the Chennai park. And Orissa, the Orissa government actually came to this company, said, why don't you come and make a park here? We'll give you land for really cheap. They got a very big land bank for, I think, just 3 crore rupees near to Bhubaneswar. Yeah, right. And they're projecting about 110 crores of capex here. So that will be their fifth park. So this is the basic idea of the thing. They have got three major sources of revenue. So parks are a capital intensive business, and the interesting thing is Wonderla owns all the land that it has parks in. So all the land is owned by the company or you as a shareholder. The three major sources of revenues are ticket sales at the entry. So you basically go to the park, buy a ticket, and then you can do all the rides you want inside the park. In-park purchases, that is food and beverage. Excuse me, my cuckoo clock is buzzing. So in-park beverage, food and beverages, and you've got merchandise, clothing, and other items. Okay, and the third one is resorts. So they have one resort in Bangalore. the other two parks, they don't have a resort currently. So you can see in red that I have mentioned this revenue split. And below that is the global revenue split. So one interesting thing is that in India, majorly still the revenues are coming from tickets. And, you know, in-park purchases are less as a proportion of overall revenues. Whereas globally, it is, you know, one third in each of these areas. So you can clearly see that Wonderla, which direction the company is aiming to move, you know, increase in-park purchases. You know, if I can draw parallel to the telecom sector, it's like value-added services. They want to, you know, upsell and cross-sell. Tickets is something that they do quite decently. Below, I have mentioned charts. You can have a, you can pause the video, have a detailed look at it. But the, I'll give you a quick story that, you know, the three parks, over the last 3-4 years, the footfalls have kind of stagnated. Okay, they have been able to raise the ticket prices quite consistently. Okay, by 5%, 10% odd. And the good thing is that the in-park purchases, they have been growing at a very steady rate. So if you can see the red scatter lines, red lines that are there in each of those three graphs, even though the in most of the parks, the footfalls have slightly declined. You know, Bangalore has about 10 lakh footfalls a year, Kochi about 7.5 lakh, Hyderabad has about, you know, similar numbers as Kochi. The revenues have been going up, which is a positive sign for this company. And also another thing that I would like to add here is the last 3-4 years have been quite a difficult time in terms of business. They've been hit with a lot of things. For example, demonetization came in, then GST, they had service tax issues. GST was initially 28% on amusement parks, which was kind of a punishment for them. It priced like a sin good. But then later, the government, after a couple of quarters, rationalized it, brought it down to 18%. So that was positive for them. Then there was a Nipah virus in Kerala. There were flooding in Kerala. There were traffic issues in Bangalore. So a host of issues added to this problem of lower footfalls. But the management is confident that going forward, footfall should recover. The company should be on an upward trajectory. But then, bam, COVID and 2 quarters of complete business loss. The parks are completely shut. And the businesses, you would assume, in a precarious situation, but that is not the case. The company manages its working capital really, really well. Like I said, there is no debt on the books. The company has cash reserves of about 125 crores, 110, 125 odd crores. And the company says that it can go 1 year, you know, without really taking on debt. It can pay its operating expenses. They have brought down their operating expenses significantly. So that is a very positive about the company. It's a robust company, despite having heavy capital expenses. It's a robust company. It has flexibility. That is something very positive about this stock.
Right, Kalpak. So that's absolutely right. You mentioned about a host of issues the company has been facing in the last couple of years. And call it fate or whatever you want, that starts with the moment the company went public. That was in 2015. And we see here, you know, the price movement we have is absolutely flattish. So a majority of Indian people, or rather, you know, retail investors across the globe, they don't like to see charts like this, right? So, but then there is more to the story than the chart, okay? You know, for the moment, let us ignore, let us assume that, you know, there is worth discussing about this company. And let's quickly take a look at the 10-year numbers, okay? Yeah. So a couple of things I want to highlight here is, number one, they have not raised a lot of equity. You know, they have not diluted a lot of equity. Okay, so 170 crores is what they raised in the year 2015. And historically, if you see, the company has been very prudent in raising capital. Okay, like Kalpak said, they have created almost all of their assets using their internal accruals. Okay, so that's a first sign of a very well-run company, according to me. Okay. Talking about the cash flows, row number two, you see the cash flows are more than the profits. Now, how does that happen? The answer is simple. The company has a lot of depreciation on its books, okay, because of which it gets added back, and in the form of cash flows, it's always more than the profits that they generate, okay. If we take a look at the sales, you know, sales growth rate and the operating profit growth rate versus the net profit growth rate, you would see that the net profit growth rate is lesser than the, you know, the top line growth rate. Now, the reason for that is, again, as a company is adding new parks, they are bound to have a higher depreciation, okay? And as a percentage of sales, if you see, currently the depreciation for Wonderla is around 10% of the sales annually, okay? So now what that means is, you know, annually, you know, 10% of their assets need to be replaced. So I'll come to that particular concept of replacement of assets, where we are going to talk about capital expenditure, Now, we are talking about a company, Kalpak, which is in a capital intensive industry.
Okay? Right.
And there's one concept that I want to briefly touch upon is capital expenditure can be bifurcated into two major heads. Okay. So I have used the terminology here, growth capex and maintenance capex. Okay.
Right.
And across the board, this is the terminology. You'll get to see a lot of content around these two terms. Okay. And then the maintenance capex I have classified into one, which is, you know, a normal, you know, refurbishment kind of a capex wherein, you know, their existing rides would be refurbished or, you know, safety standards would be adhered to. Okay. And the second term that I have used here is the obsolescence capex. Now, I would like to take a minute and tell you what is obsolescence capex. Okay. So I have a very, very different example here. Okay. What I'm trying to say here is if you see on the left, there are three guys. Okay. You know, guy on the leftmost side is 90 kgs, probably 90, 95 kgs. And then he's trying to jog it out and bring his weight down to around 70. Now, if you see from image one to image two, that's not a very drastic transition when you compare it, you know, from image one to image three. Okay. So I would put it this way that if you're transitioning from image one to image two, you're probably maintaining yourself. All right. And to maintain yourself, you may need a couple of, you know, maybe 15 minutes of cardio every day, but that's not exactly growing or that's not exactly improving in life. Okay. So if you want to transition from stage one to stage three, you'll have to put in a lot of efforts and maybe, you know, you'll have to hit a gym or you'll have to take up to a sport. Okay. So this is exactly growth. Now, if I compare it vis-a-vis with the situation, you know, assume that this is the customer base of Wonderla. So this is stage one, stage two, and stage three. If they want to transition from a stage one to stage three, there are no prizes for guessing. This has to be new park additions, right? So this is basically the growth capex, okay? But if you want to transition from stage one to stage two, or if you want to maintain your footfalls, you have to spend a certain amount of money every year, which is termed as maintenance capex, okay? Right. So I'm also going to talk about the obsolescence capex. Okay, so here I broadly use the term maintenance, but I'll touch upon what is obsolescence capex. Yes, Kalpak, you want to tell about how the depreciation thing works? So
that was a very good analogy, Avinit.
Thank you.
You know, and two types of capex. One is growth, the other maintenance. I expect to hear more on that. But before that, we'll quickly understand how single park economics work. Okay. This is quite an interesting slide. If you look at the part above the line, I want you to only focus on that. A new park, the Chennai park, for example, it's going to cost a capex of about 350 crores. And, you know, the bottom of the story is the ROC, return on capital employed, at the end of year one is going to be 7%. And you would say, I mean, you know, Kalpak, 7%, is that good enough for me? You know, I can get that in an FD. And it's not the kind of business I want to invest in. But, you know, you have to look at how it plays out in the longer term. Okay, because this is a capital investment that has a larger life cycle. Okay, there is an inherent land asset based on it, on which you add value. And you've got constantly, you know, people coming in, revenues generated from that.
Right.
Also, brand properties that can be leveraged on a future date. Okay. Right. Again, here you can see something as a maintenance capex at 10% is what I've mentioned. So what Wonderla does is every year, about 10% of the revenue generated per park, they reinvest into the business to get new rides, new attractions, so that, you know, the same people can be rebought into the, you know, okay, there's a new ride in town. Let's go check it out. Okay. It's a once in a year activity with the kids. Everyone's excited. So that's something to keep it all fresh. So that's something that is required. Otherwise, you know, the business starts, you know, tanking because nobody wants to go to the same old thing again and again. Okay. So after year 10, if you see the return on capital will be about somewhere 25 to 30%. Okay. I'll not get into the details of it in the discussion, but do check out the description below if you want some notes on it and how we've arrived at that number. And this is based on some past data that we've taken from the company. So over a period of time, the company starts generating good returns, and it also constantly generates free cash flow. And this free cash flow can then further be used of all combined parks to grow, you know, to add together and, you know, invest in the newer park. So in
it's
a
like
way,
a, It's like a self-sustaining process in itself.
Right, right.
Company generates cash flows and utilizes them to, you know, grow number of parks.
Absolutely. So as the park gets older, firstly it gets more profitable, and those profits can then be then contribute to new properties that they can enter into. And the testament for this is they have not really raised any debt. Okay, the COVID crisis, they may have to for the Chennai plant, okay, but that's not a very high debt level. That's something that the company should be able to service, provided their operations resume over a period of time, I believe. But something that gets overlooked is the land bank that they hold. And is this company an asset play? Okay, by asset play, I mean, do they have assets that can be mobilized in a bad situation? Or if it, you know, inherent value of the business, if it you know, kind of propels it up. If you see on the right, you know, this is taken from the annual report. They say our land bank is one of our key assets. Okay. So I just took some numbers from 99 acres and I calculated the price of their total land holdings. My calculation says it's about 950 crores. Okay. I'm no real estate expert. Okay. But I think based on some data, some properties that are being sold nearby, I got the kind of values per square feet. And that is a number that I'm able to come up with. The fair value shown on the company's books is 510 crores. Okay, so it will be safe to assume that it will be somewhere between that. Okay, 750 crores, 800 crores. And the fair value is, I think, a 2018 number. So there has been definite improvement since then. Currently, the stock trades at about 160 rupees a share, making its market cap to about 950 crores. And if you see the land value itself is 950 crores. So essentially, what this means, Avineet, is if you buy one stock in Wonderla, you're actually simply buying their land. It is like an investment in land. You're not paying anything for all the free cash flow that it can generate. And the reason why the stock has tanked in recent times is because operations are shut. People don't know what the future looks like. But I think this is a deep discount in this market. Over the last 20 years, the company has shown consistent abilities to attract people. Its Google reviews are 4.5 out of 5 for all three parks. And there are tens of thousands of reviews. It's a good, good business to be in. And I really feel excited that we have identified this kind of an asset.
Great, 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 Kalpak. Very, very well explained that was. Okay. So, so let us talk about, you know, briefly what all we have discussed. So we are talking about a business which is, it's a capital intensive business in a tourism deprived country like India. Okay. So Kalpak mentioned that here in India, we have 1/10 of the number of amusement park that China has. Okay. You may hate that we are comparing India with China, but that's the reality. We have to do it. The population base of both the countries is the same, right? And guys, this business comes from a very well established house. Okay, the house of V-Guard is highly, it's a respected house in the market, not just in the investor community, but in the vendor community as well. Okay, so there is very little doubt in corporate governance, or there is any, you know, there's very little that you can do with respect to, you know, checking their governance standards. Okay, it's a debt-free business. The company doesn't believe in the company doesn't believe in raising a lot of debt. Not just debt, they are not even guys who will dilute their equity unnecessarily. Okay, so from a shareholder perspective, it's an excellent thing, I would say. Okay, working capital is close to zero. Rather, you know, if you go and check the receivable days would come to about 1 or 2. Okay, that's because they get all their cash upfront. Okay. And lastly, the valuation is very attractive. Okay, so like Kalpak said, the stock is trading close to its intrinsic value. And it means that in the case of liquidation, you're not going to lose much. Okay, so I've heard this from people that why buy a stock where the company is not functioning for, you know, for the last 6 months. Okay, the answer is the company is quite close to its liquidation value. Okay, and as a value investor, it gives a comfort that, you know, if you're buying close to the liquidation value, even if the company has to close down operations, it's quite okay. Okay. Now, on the other side, the long gestation period for construction of the parks is something that goes against the company. Okay. Cost of obsolescence is something we've already discussed. And COVID has put a dent. Now, how exactly COVID has affected the businesses? Like Kalpak said initially, the company is a self-sustaining machine where they generate cash flows and then they use those cash flows to, you know, start other parks. Okay. Now, one full year for the company is gone. Okay. So 6 months are already gone. And the coming 6 months, the company doesn't expect to start any meaningful functions. Okay, we all know what is the situation of COVID in India. Okay, yeah. Now this 1 year of lost cash flow, it means changes in the company's capital allocation plans. Okay, they may have to raise some debt for building their Chennai project, which is which is already under construction, and they are very much committed to building that to completing that project as soon as possible. Okay. So that's how COVID has affected. And you know, you see, Kalpak, from a capital allocation perspective, the market, if you see, a majority of the market participants or investors are, they want to keep away from capital intensive industries. You know, nobody today wants to run operations efficiently, you know. So the trend today, the buzzword today is aggregator, where people want to own the customer. You know, owning the customer is quite overrated, according to me. Anyway, that's a completely different matter. We are talking about a company which has its heart and soul in running operations of the business, okay? And that's why we are saying on promoters, we are giving it a 5-on-5 valuation. Like we have mentioned, it's a business, you know, which is trading quite close to its liquidation value, intrinsic value. Now, the reason we are saying 3-on-5 for a business is because we are still talking about a business which is capital intensive in India, where the cost of capital is quite high, okay? So this is not a business which is going to give you rapid growth. Okay, it's not a business which will give you multi-bagger returns in 5 years or 7 years. Okay, it's kind of a long hold. You need conviction for the business. You need conviction for the promoters. And if you don't have that, then please you may consider it accordingly, not owning the stock. So that's all, guys. That's all we had today on this particular stock or company, Wandala Holidays. Thank you, everyone.
So yeah, hope you guys enjoyed this video. Let us know what you think of this talk. Please feel free to like, share the video. We would really like if you subscribe to our channel. There'll be one of this video coming up every week. And hope you enjoyed this cup of chai. Thank you.
Thank you.